it gives the symptoms of pregnancy like hyperemesis. It will be a little higher only. Vomiting, all the symptoms will be there. So it is a heterogeneous group of intralytic lesion arising from the trophoblastic epithelium. The problem arises from the trophoblastic epithelium of the placenta. The predominant tumor marker is beta HCG, and because you very well know that in your first year itself you would have studied the beta HCG is secreted by the trophoblastic cells. So there is abnormal proliferation of the trophoblastic cells, so we have a very great amount of beta HCG being secreted here. Then how can we classify the gestational trophoblastic disease? The gestational trophoblastic disease, we differentiate into grossly as benign and malignant. And the benign is the hydatidiform mole. In turn, it is divided into complete mole and partial mole. Complete mole is that is there is only, easy to understand is complete mole is there is only the molar structures. Partial mole is you will have the fetal structures. Along with that, you will have that molar changes. Then comes the gestational trophoblastic neoplasia, that is malignancy, and that is divided into invasive mole, choriocarcinoma, placental site trophoblastic tumor, epithelial trophoblastic tumor. These are, though it is not uncommon, we have to know about this to rule out that it is not a malignancy. So it is a spectrum of trophoblastic disease, gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. It has invasive mole, choriocarcinoma, placental site trophoblastic tumor, epithelial trophoblastic tumor. So now let us discuss what is the etiology of the molar pregnancy. Etiology is immunological factors, racial factors, dietary factors. The risk factors are extremes of age less than 15 years and more than 40 years, and prior history of molar pregnancy, previous spontaneous abortion. Then your diet increased incidence in high carbohydrate diet, malnutrition, debilitated condition, repetitive hydatidiform moles in women with different partners. These are some of the risk factors. And what is the incidence? Incidence is more in, it is said in, rate is 10 times higher in Asian countries, and the incidence is highest in Philippines. And what is the chromosomal basis of the development? How does it chromosomally, how it develops, and how to differentiate chromosomally the molar pregnancy? So as we discussed earlier, we said it is two way, complete and partial. Complete, as I said, it is fully molar. Partial, you have a fetal structure plus molar. The complete, you see in two forms, that is diploid. Partial also, partial you'd see as a triploid or tetraploid. Like what do you understand with diploid and triploid means? In the diploid, 96% fertilization of an empty ovum by one sperm that undergoes duplication. So that it is an empty ovum, and 96% the empty ovum is fertilized by a single sperm. So 46XX it will be. When the rest of 4% fertilization of an empty ovum by two sperms, when there are two sperms which is fertilizing an empty ovum, it gives a chromosomal type as 46XX and 46XY. In triploid, 90% triploid fertilization of a normal ovum. The difference is there is an empty ovum, here is a normal ovum. It will be fertilized by two sperms. So that you see that it is shown as 69XXX, 69YXX and 69YY and X. So 10% are tetraploid fertilization, that is a normal ovum by three sperms. So if you go deep inside, you will understand some more. So what happens in a complete mole? It is there is an empty ovum and a single sperm goes and fertilizes. It duplicates and it shows us comes the chromosomal outcome is 46XX because of the duplication. So in a complete ovum, same empty ovum is fertilized by two sperms, 23X and 23X. So it comes as 46XX. In a partial mole, here the ovum is not empty. It is a normal ovum already carrying 23X chromosomes. So two sperms are fertilizing and it comes as 23X plus 23Y plus 23X, 69XXY. Familial biparental hydatidiform mole. Familial biparental hydatidiform mole is inherited in an autosomal recessive pattern. This we need not study more, it is a post-graduation level. So describe the, how to describe a complete hydatiform mole. This is the important tabular column, which itself will give a good marks in the presentation. It's a, this, if we by heart are, you understand, things are over. So there is two differentiate things, that partial mole and complete mole. The partial mole karyotyping is 69XXX or 69XXY. So it is a partial mole. That partial mole means there is normal fetus structure plus your molar changes. That's why the chromosomal things are high. Then other thing is complete mole, where it is 46XX or 46Y. So as I clearly said, in partial mole you have fetus, na? Yeah, it is often present. Complete mole, it is absent. Amnion, fetal RBC usually present, absent. Villus edema, variable, focus, diffuse. So the clinical presentation will be like a missed abortion in partial mole. It is a partial mole. We'll see like a missed abortion because the fetal structures will be inside, and you will see that the abortion is being missed and it is about abort. So in complete mole, it is a fully molar gestation. In partial mole, since there is fetal structure, you will see that it is like a small four dates baby. That means it doesn't correspond to your last menstrual period, and the growth of the fetus is slow. It will mimic like that. But in complete mole, it will be large four dates, because the grape-like structures which multiplies, it will give a great size, that it will be more, the height of the uterus when you are palpating and seeing, it will be like more than your expected gestational period for the LMP. So thecal lutein cysts are rare. Here it is 25 to 30%. Medical complications are rare in partial mole. Complete mole, it is little bit higher. Post-molar gestational trophoblastic, see, the mole can traverse and it can transfer itself into a gestational trophoblastic neoplasm, which is more in complete mole than in the partial mole. What is the pathological features of complete hydatiform mole? Macroscopically, the complete mole, this macroscopically, these microscopic Hello? Changes
transfer.
Yeah.
Sir, slide change pandringla sir, mara mariye theriyala.
Enga nikire, where it does it stop?
First slide da sir.
Oh, I'm changing the slides actually.
Now changing. Ipa change aayi sir. Okay.
What slide you are seeing now?
Complete hydatiform.
Yeah, yeah. Now you are seeing some histological change? No.
No, sir.
Now?
Yes, sir. No, it's...
Yeah, let it be.
Yes.
Okay, good. So this is the histological features of a complete hydatiform mole. Okay, I think you have missed some few good slides of tabular column. Okay, now it will be, this is also sufficient. This is the way it will be looking like. It will be like what, jelly current like substance with bunch of grapes. While we evacuate, this is the structure we will be evacuating during our procedures. So the, what will be the clinical features of complete mole is, there is a history of amenorrhea for around 8 to 12 weeks. It's a complete mole. There is irregular vaginal bleeding, expulsion of grape-like vesicles sporogenum. The patient will be complaining that, sir, something is coming outside. It is like grape-like structure which we are palpating. It is it is like a grape. It is like a ripe grapes. So then they'll be having a lower abdominal pain, overstretching of the uterus. As I said, due to the grape-like structure, the uterus will be overstretching. There will be a concealed hemorrhage, and you will not have a typical hemorrhage. It will be like little bit like concealed like. Then uterine contraction to expel out the content. Sometimes it gets infected. Sometimes it perforates if it is going to be a invasive mole. So the hydatiform mole usually is associated with excessive uterine enlargement, thecal lutein cysts, hyperthyroidism, hyperemesis gravidarum, as we already said. HCG is more secreted, and that is definitely hyperemesis gravidarum here. Marked elevated HCG around 100,000 units, international units per ml, you will have a breathlessness or acute respiratory distress. That is why any hydatiform mole you are suspecting will be asking for a chest X-ray, because we will have a secondary changes like invasion in the lung in hydatiform mole. What to see in a point should be noted in general examination. Patient looks more ill and paler, and there is tachycardia, there is tachypnea. Some features of pre-eclampsia may be present. usually there is yearly onset of preeclampsia also. Uterine enlargement is, as I already said, it is more than expected. The uterus is soft, duffy feeling you will be having. Fetal parts are not felt. In partial mole, you will be feeling that fetal parts also along with this duffy feeling. That it's not even, it, that is not so typical in clinical examination. Ultrasound is the confirmative diagnostic tool. But clinically also, initially due to before the period of USG, clinicians were able to diagnose it with clinical knowledge itself. That time it will, the partial mole will be like with the fetal parts with this duffy feeling, but in the complete mole it will be fully duffy feeling. Fetal heart sounds cannot be detected. You'll be searching for the fetal heart sound, it will not be there in complete mole. In cervical examination, cervical os may be open or may or may not be open. Metastasis may appear as purple nodule if there is a metastasis. PVLA should check for the uterine size, and internal ballotment cannot be elicited. If it is a fetal thing, it is there inside, it will be, if the fetus is inside the amniotic fluid and cavity, you will have a ballotment, but that is not seen here in complete mole. Unilateral or bilateral thickal lutein cyst of ovary is palpable. Adnexa may not be free. This is the partial hydatidiform mole. How does it look like? It's a maternal side and the partial hydatidiform mole. Fetus anomaly, which is seen in partial mole. This is partial hydatidiform mole. See, the mole is also there, fetus is also there. Clinical features of partial mole. How does a partial mole? Initially, we discussed about complete mole, it's a partial mole. There is a vaginal bleeding, usually diagnosed as a miss or incomplete abortion. Uterus corresponds to small for gestational age. There is a fetus, but it is small for gestational age. It will be like a small for gestational age. Excessive uterus in size is noted. Toxemia of pregnancy is there. How to diagnose means you would take a complete history, clinical examination, ultrasound examination, serum HCG levels, which will be abnormally high, which doesn't correlate with a normal pregnancy. Then you can take a histopathological examination. Cytogenic and molecular biological examination are helpful. All other things you don't need. Ultrasound is helpful in making a pre-evacuation diagnosis, but the definite diagnosis is made by histological examination. Early ultrasound, you see early detection reduced from 16 weeks to 12 weeks, passage of vesicles. Beta HCG levels are two multiples of median, may be of value in diagnostic, often exceeding 10 power 5 of international units per liter. Okay, guidelines to HCG levels during pregnancy. This is important thing. Normally, what happens to the HCG? 3 weeks LMP, 5 to 50, 4 weeks LMP, 4 to 20. These are the normal values which you see for a normal pregnancy HCG levels. This will be doubled in a molar pregnancy. See the vesicles, very nicely it is shown microscopically. This is ultrasound finding, how will it be? Normally, you would have seen some ultrasounds, or you may see in the future that there is a uterus. Inside the uterus, you will have a gestational sac or amniotic cavity. Inside that, you will have a fetal parts. Here, what you see is some hypoechoic. Hypoechoic means that black-like structures, which is inside on a ground glass appearance thing. And those are the vesicles. These things are the vesicles, and that will pave way for you to diagnose the hydatidiform mole. Okay. Diagnostic features are more, and what is the plan of management? There are two important basic lines of management. One is evacuation of the mole. Everything has its own risk. Just like that, we cannot go and evacuate a hydatidiform mole. Actually, evacuation is the treatment. Then after that, studying the mole with histopathological examination, checking it for any malignant changes, all those are steps. But initially, how to plan what to do with this hydatidiform mole. Regular follow-up to detect the persistent trophoblastic disease. Any hydatidiform mole, even if it is a benign, it is a complete moles are have a chance of going for gestational trophoblastic neoplasia of around 10 to 15%, which we discussed previously. So you should always have in mind that this may change into neoplasia, though it is a benign condition. Okay, the management of trophoblastic gestational trophoblastic disease. Pre-evacuation HCG has to be noted, complete blood count, electrolytes, liver function test, thyroid function test, imaging like pelvic ultrasound, chest X-ray. I said why we are taking chest X-ray. Already I said that chest X-ray is needed here. How to, the patient should be stabilized hemodynamically. Most of the time they come in a shock, they come in this severe pain abdomen, they are anemic also. So the anemia, dehydration, hyperthyroidism, hypertension, everything has to be corrected. What is the best method of evacuating a molar pregnancy? Suction evacuation is the best method and can be done by conventional suction curettage as well as manual vacuum aspiration. Two MVA sheets should be available. Manual vacuum aspiration, you would have seen there is a menstrual leg radio, I'll show you later. Normally, we introduce a cannula, you connect that cannula with a suction apparatus and you can suck it. And it has its own complication that perforation is the most common thing when you suck vigorously or you poke vigorously, because it is like a gravid uterus and the uterus will be very thin and soft. So the suction should be done with a plastic cannula, not with a metal curettage or something like that. Or with the manual vacuum aspiration syringe. It is also a syringe which is connected to a soft cannula. With that you can suck it. So cervical preparation with prostaglandins, your mesoprostal PGE1 should be given. Prostaglandin E1, which dilates the cervix and it softens the cervix so that you enter easily to suck it and take the products out. So for partial mole means there is a fetal part also. For partial mole, small fetal parts, you should do a suction curettage. Large fetal parts, if there are large fetal parts, you cannot suck and take it out. You should give oxytocins like oxytocin, or even your mesoprostal itself will contract the uterus and it will send the baby out, the parts of the baby or the small for dead baby out. Okay. In partial mole, the oxytocin is safe as the sort of emboli and disseminated tropoplastic tissue is very low. This is the MVA syringe. That syringe, it is shown on the top. This is the syringe. And once you attach this cannula here and you pull this lever, it will come and stuck here and creating a vacuum inside these places. So once you connect this cannula here, you introduce inside the uterus and release this vacuum, suddenly the products of conception will enter, it will be sucked here, it will be stored here. So once it is stored here, you again lock it up, remove the cannula here and dislodge the secretion products, whatever you have taken through this nozzle, and repeat the process again. This is very safe and the pressure is fixed. It is not going to be more than what is the fixed pressure, so that the uterus doesn't get injured and it is not oversucked. So this is the way. This is another way which I said, see, the suction cannula is directly connected to a suction catheter, to a suction machine, and ultrasound guided. When you do this with the ultrasound guided, lively you are performing an ultrasound, see the cannula is inside, you're sucking the vesicular mole, and when you do it lively with the help of ultrasound, you can know the extent till where you are going. This is the fundus of the uterus. If you are crossing this fundus of the uterus, you are going to enter into the peritoneum. So at least 1 inch or 2 inches away from the fundus, you should place the tip of the catheter and you start sucking. All these things will be sucked in the cannula, and this is also easy. A supervision of a senior surgeon should be maintained. 2 IV lines should be maintained because the patient may suddenly go in for hypotension. That time you may need to correct the blood pressure with your isotonic saline, or sometimes you may need, if it is over bleeding, you may need the transfusion of blood also, but it is very rare that we have used blood and all. We have seen the patient is going for the hypertension, we corrected with the normal saline and ringer lactate solution to correct the volume. So the deep incision of cannula should be avoided, which I said. Gentle curettage should be present. Intraoperative USG we can use it. This is the way it will come. Some amount of amniotic fluid also will be there. And these are that amniotic fluid. These are the products which we have sucked and we have placed it in the bottom. So at times anti-D should be, is it required or not, is a very great discussion. In complete mole, because of the poor vascularization of chorionic villi and absence of anti-D antigen, anti-D prophylaxis is not required. Complete mole you don't require, but in partial mole, since there is a fetus, there is a chance of transmission of blood between fetus and the mother. So in partial mole you may need anti-D. What to do after this? you have sucked it, there was a vesicle hormone, how to safely do a contraception following gestation trophoblastosis. Barrier method is most preferred method, like using condom or all those things. Oral contraceptive method, one, the beta HCG level is normalized. After the suction evacuation, we will be checking the beta HCG regularly. First, regularly, we will do it every week. Then we will be doing in every 6 months. The pregnancy should be delayed for another 1 year at least. So if that is the case, your oral contraceptive method will be helpful, like combined oral contraceptive pill may be used. Low dose of OCP is preferred. And IUCD should not be used. IUCD is intrauterine contraceptive device, like copper T, should not be used until the beta HCG levels are normal, because if the beta HCG levels are high, still the uterus is soft and there is trophoblastic remnants are inside. If that is the case, you will perforate the uterus with the IUCD. So you are not permitted to use IUCD. Permanent sterilization is preferred if at all they have completed the family. Since this is the first time she is becoming pregnant and is landing up in a high dirty form mole, you cannot go for the permanent sterilization. Hysterectomy may be preferred for the person who has completed the family and she is more than 40 years and she is not having any desire to continue going for a next pregnancy or like that. Hysterectomy is the best option. Also, we should not forget that hysterectomy does not eliminate the paucity of gestational trophoblastic disease. It is markedly reduced its likelihood. Post-hysterectomy gestational trophoblastic neoplasia is also observed in 3 to 5% of cases. It's a complete hydatidiform mole associated with complete thecalutein cyst with the hydatidiform mole. Okay. Prophylactic chemotherapy. What to do? The long-term prognosis for women with the hydatidiform mole is not improved with the prophylactic chemotherapy because toxicity are those there. It doesn't improve. Prophylactic chemotherapy after molar pregnancy. Once you evacuate, the controversial practice of prophylactic chemotherapy is not recommended. Unnecessary exposure to toxic adverse effects happens. So the prophylactic chemotherapy in one randomized clinical trial, a single course of methotrexate, 0.4 milligram per kilogram radiate, and folinic acid reduces the incidence of post-molar trophoblastic disease in patients with high-risk moles. If they are more than 40 years, previous history of molar pregnancy. For all these people, you can give a prophylactic chemotherapy where we think about the risk and benefit factors. Though there is a risk, benefit factor, benefit percentage is more, means we are ready to take the risk. With that risk, we can go for this prophylactic chemotherapy. Beta HCG levels greater than 100,000 milli international units per ml, uterine size is greater than gestational, ovarian size greater than 6 cm, all this was there, means you can go for prophylactic chemotherapy. Post evacuation, how are you going to surveillance the patient? How are you going to check the patient, how she is, how we are going to surveillance her to determine when pregnancy can be allowed, to detect persistent trophoblastic disease, all these things will. So baseline beta HCG level is obtained within 48 hours. You should check after the evacuation, 48 hours, you should check baseline beta HCG. Then only you know whether it is falling down or rising down. Almost it is going to be very high than the normal pregnancy, but we should know what is the baseline beta HCG after the evacuation. It could be in thousands also, sometimes it could be 10,000 also. So levels are monitored every week, as I earlier said, every week you should monitor. Till 8 to 10 weeks. After that, monitor HCG every month for further 6 months from the date of evacuation. If HCG has to return to normal within 15 to 56 days after pregnancy event. More than 56 days of pregnancy event was there, means follow up in 6 months from normalization of HCG level. So initially, if, I said it is from the day of evacuation. Now, normalization of HCG level, you should check for another 6 months if it is more than the pregnancy event was more than 56 days. These levels should progressively fall to an undetectable level. Sometimes it says the report comes is undetectable also, but that is very rare. But less than 5 milli international units per ml is sufficient for us. In a resource poor setting where you cannot check the HCG regularly, means you can do a monthly USG 1 month after evacuation. UPT also could. We should, UPT should be performed once in a month starting UPT. Pelvic examination, while HCG is elevated to monitor the involution of pelvic structures and to aid in the identification of metastasis, only for that purpose, if there is any metastasis, we can find it out with the pelvic examination. Complicated associated with malar pregnancy. There are things during perforation can happen with the mold itself. Excessive hemorrhage can happen, respiratory distress syndrome. This is a rare event, the respiratory distress syndrome, though we will not discuss about that. Coming to your OP, or even your, if you are not a gynecologist, you are, somebody is coming to you and they will ask to say, I had an IUD for mole which has been evacuated, when can I go get into pregnancy again? So there you should know all these things. Recommendations for management subsequent pregnancy, parvogenic in first trimester and ultrasound to confirm normal gestational development and dates, examination of the placenta, the products of conception histologically at the time of delivery or evacuation. If at all you are going for an evacuation or you are going for a normal pregnancy also, you should check the placenta and everything. An HCG level should be obtained 6 weeks and 10 weeks post evacuation or delivery to confirm normalization. A hydrated for mole and coexisting fetus, this can happen. Prevalence is 0.005 to 0.1%. How do you diagnose? Means it is an ultrasound diagnosis. And complications are increased risk of medical complications, increased post, same thing, post-molar gestational diploid disease. One other thing you should remember is false positive HCG values are also known as phantom HCG. The presence of non-specific heterophil antibodies in the patient's sera can cause this phantom HCG. Should be suspected if the HCG values plateau at relatively low levels and do not respond to therapeutic maneuvers. Evaluation of patient with urinary HCG, serial dilution of serum, prognosis means the post-molar gestational prophylactic disease. Following complete mole, it is 20%. Following partial mole, it is 5%. And the risk of recurrence with the prior molar pregnancy is 1 to 4%. Okay. This is FIGO staging. I don't think these things are needed for you. This is the last slide. And indication for therapy is for gestational prophylaxis. Yeah? Indication for therapy. Evacuation is Hessian pattern. An HCG histological diagnosis of choriocarcinoma or placental site heteroplastic histological diagnosis. If it says choriocarcinoma or placental site heteroplastic tumor, we can coin that as gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. And the presence of metastasis, high HCG levels, persistent elevated HCG. Even 6 months after post-evacuation, suspect, or if all these points are there, suspect or any one of the points is there, suspect GTN and go for chemo. If it is a hydrated hormone, evacuate, do serial beta HCG level. If it resolutes, okay. If it is going to be a gestational prophylactic neoplasm, do a FIGO scoring, low risk less than 6, high risk more than 6 points means. Single agent methotrexate is okay for FIGO staging less than 6. If it is more than 6, combination of MAC and IMACO and chemotherapy. And do a serial HCG level. If it resolutes, okay. If it is relapsing again, it is a resistant disease, go for second line chemotherapy and surgical debulking. This is the way how to manage a hydrated for mole from a benign condition and a neoplastic condition. Hope some vague idea you would have got. And if you go deep into the books, you will get some more points also. And I hope I have enlightened some vague or an eagle's eye view of what is a trophoblastic disease.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, okay. Then anything you want to ask? If you have any questions, you can ask, or else you write up. No problem.
Yeah, I think anyone have any questions? we can close the call, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.